on on-premise servers, then you will have to spend time, efforts, and you need to have a dedicated team of IT professional that who will manage your Kubernetes cluster, your on-premise Kubernetes cluster. And as you might have guessed, a managed Kubernetes cluster simply means that Microsoft, your cloud vendor, will take care of some management of your Kubernetes cluster. The entire Kubernetes control plane will be managed internally by Microsoft. You just have to manage your workload. And the control plane or the management plane, you have no cost for it. You have to pay only for the, you know, the workload that you have deployed, the amount of worker machines you have provisioned on your Kubernetes cluster. And because it has a tight integration with other Azure services, like for example, Azure Active Directory, you get built-in integration with Azure Active Directory in Kubernetes. It can be integrated with existing Azure monitoring and logging tools, like Azure Monitor can be connected with your Kubernetes cluster. It also has a new feature, relatively new feature, which allows you to have GPU-enabled nodes. It has built-in support for using Azure Disk or Blob Storage as a storage provisioner. So you might have your workload using Azure Blob or Azure File Share as storage provisioner or storage backend for your external volumes or for your volumes. It has a very good integration with virtual network, Azure Virtual Network. So you can have your, let's say, an Azure SQL database deployed somewhere connected to our Azure Virtual Network, and you can link or you can connect your Kubernetes cluster also in the same virtual network. Or you can do some kind of virtual network peering so that, you know, your other Azure services or your other infrastructure or PaaS services on Azure can also communicate with your Kubernetes cluster. At the end, there is one more feature, which is relatively newer one, Application Gateway Ingress Controller. You can use this ingress controller to link or to connect your Kubernetes workload to your Azure Application Gateway as well. Now, how many of you have worked with containers, any kind of containers? Like you may have used Docker alone or Docker with Kubernetes both. Anyone? You can drop messages in the chat window as well, because I have logged in into another device and I'm just looking at the chat messages now. Okay, no issues. So containerization is basically a new trend, relatively a new trend, which allows you to package your application in some sort of generic packages. So forget about a .NET developer building a .dll file, Java application developer building a .jar or .var file, and so on. Now, all your developers have to do is they have to build a generic package for their application. So instead of using file formats like DLLs or jars or zips or tarballs and so on, your developers have to build a container image, a generic packaging format, you can say it is, for all their applications, which will include all its dependencies, all its configuration, all its application binaries, and etc., everything. So it is like, you know, you are just taking your entire dev environment, converting it into a kind of a generic package, right? So that you can deploy it as it is into the next environment. Ramesh here has mentioned he is using containers for gateway implementation for Cassandra and Kong. Yeah, that's great. There are lot many ready-to-use base images available on Docker Hub, by the way. Docker Hub is a public repository where you can find lot many ready-to-use container images. Obviously, before you use them in production, you will have to scan them for any kind of vulnerabilities if they have, and you will have to also look after, or you will have to also check whether those images are, you can say, official images from their vendor, because Docker Hub is a public domain and anyone, me and you, can build their own container images and publish them over there. Okay, no issues. Kubernetes is a very, very sophisticated container orchestration tool which allows us to get our entire container workload or entire application workload managed by this automated tool or this orchestrator called Kubernetes. So here I'll be using some CVs, concept visuals, to explain few of these concepts. And I'll be sharing all the diagrams with you, whatever I draw here. So we start with containers part. As I said, containers are generic packages, and what they actually contain, they contain all your application and its dependencies. So when you build a container image, it could actually contain different kind of application. Like for example, you might have 2-3 different container images, and each one of them might actually contain different kind of application. Like for example, this container image here might contain a Java application, JDK, Tomcat, and a Java web application. On the same time, the other container image might actually contain something like .NET runtime with, let's say, ASP.NET Core framework and your ASP MVC application. You might also have another container image which contains, yes.
Mahendra, are you typing anything? I'm not able to see anything. I can just see the PPT.
Oh, sorry. I'll just share the screen again.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Yeah. Can you see it here?
Yeah, now we can see it. Thank you.
Okay, welcome. So you will see we have got containerization is actually container images are basically generic packages, and they may contain any kind of application. So this is, let's say, a Python application with some kind of framework like Flask, for example, or Django and so on with your web app code. Now, one of the greatest benefit of using container is that your container images not just contain application and its dependencies, but it also contains, you can say, all the required configurations. Configurations can be stored in form of .yaml file, .xml file, or they could be simply environment variables. Okay, so applications configuration, and not just that, the command to launch your application is also stored right there inside that container image. You know what is benefit of having that command, whatever command is used or necessary for launch this application, benefit of storing that command to launch right there inside container image is that at production or at runtime, whoever is going to run this container image or convert this into a container instance and launch it, that person doesn't need to remember, or that person doesn't need to actually learn how to launch a Java-based web application or how to launch .NET-based ASP.NET application or Python-based Flask application, right? They will just run the container, and container itself will go inside its configuration section and find out what is the command that is required to launch this particular app. It will do it automatically. Now, things becomes too easier for dev and ops. Responsibility of dev now is to just build the container images and put these container images in some private container registry. Let's say this is a private container registry. So what your developers will do? Developers are supposed to build application and convert them into container images. And then these container images could be later pushed to this private container registry. On the other side, what ops team will do? Ops team will do the reverse task. They will download the container image. This is our ops team, and ops team is supposed to pull the container images and deploy them in, let's say, for example, some kind of targeted environment or targeted servers. It could be probably an on-premise servers, or it could be Azure container instance, which allows you to quickly deploy a container image, or it could be something like Kubernetes, where you can just deploy your application, pull it from the container registry and deploy it here. Now, one greatest benefit here is your ops team doesn't need to know how this particular application is internally made up of, whether it is a Java-based application, whether it is .NET-based application, whether it is PHP, Perl, or Python-based application. It doesn't matter at all. Forget about application dependencies as well. You do not need to know like what are the required dependencies for individual containerized app, because your container will have all the dependencies already packaged inside it. Only thing required on the target environment is some kind of container runtime should be already there, installed already. And this is what we are going to automate now in this session using Azure Pipeline. Azure Pipeline allows us to take the application source code, build it, convert it into a container image, push it to the container registry. When required in CD part, the continuous deployment part, it can pull and deploy it to the target Kubernetes server as well. So what we are going to do, this part we are going to implement in continuous integration pipeline, build pipeline, and this part we are going to implement using continuous deployment pipeline. Okay. Any question about this container part?
Mahendra, just one question.
Yeah.
Like in case, like if you're using a Kubernetes on-premise.
Okay, yes.
Like using kubeadm and all. So if you want to use this Azure pipeline, how can we integrate that? Because if you're using as a managed service, I know that we can use it. But like if your Kubernetes or container is on-premise, how to use it where you have one master and multiple work node?
Yeah, you need to actually do three things first. Number one, you will have to create your own self-hosted build agent or self-hosted pipeline agent for Azure DevOps. Now, this pipeline agent should have visibility with your Kubernetes master node. Just check if you are able to at least ping your Kubernetes master from the self-hosted pipeline agent. I hope you know what is self-hosted agent, right? We are anyway going to discuss this later in the session.
To be honest, like actually I don't know, but like since I'm aware of Kubernetes, Kubernetes, and in our project, as I mentioned in my introduction, that we have been using this.
Yeah.
So just wanted to correlate, because since I'm learning Kubernetes, so I'm using on-premises where I'm using kubeadm. So
self-hosted pipeline agent has nothing to do with Kubernetes. It is actually Azure DevOps concept.
I don't have any idea, to be honest. So maybe like session, I can get something from it.
Yeah, no issues. We will discuss it again in the session, but right now I'm just giving you a brief idea.
No, thank you very much for this. Yeah, highly appreciate it.
Second thing you just have to do is you have to get the Kubernetes credentials. Now, Kubernetes credentials is actually nothing but your kubeconfig file. Okay, that you need to get. This file, you will have this file already in your Kubernetes master node, by the way. Okay, you can get it from your Kubernetes master. And then you just have to make sure your Azure pipeline uses self-hosted pipeline agent to run entire pipeline workflow, and the Kubernetes credential that you have created in second step. And it's done. Now, how it is done, that you will get to know more about it later when I will start with the demo. Okay.
Can you just ping in the chat window so that I can copy
I'm
that?
Doing that exactly.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah. So here I'll just. Yes.
Right. Mahendra, I also have one question.
Yes.
Yeah. So basically, we are also using Windows containers in our project, and we are using Dockerfile, and in the Dockerfile, we are mentioning our base images to Microsoft, mcr.microsoft.com, and
that's right.
A nano server, Servercu, anything else.
Right.
Right. But since Microsoft is also developing all these things, and with the security fixes, what we wanted is to use our own ACR. We are also using our own ACR, and we wanted that all these base images should be there itself. So that's one thing, is we can push these base images to our ACR, and then even the Dockerfile we can use from and in our registry. But I just want to know, is there anything, any particular concept or scenario where we can restrict pulling the images in the Dockerfile from Docker Hub? Can we do that on a runtime basis pipeline?
If you want to put that kind of restrictions in your pipeline, what you can do is, or what is actually recommended, see, in DevOps, there is an inner loop and an outer loop. Inner loop is where developer will simply create the DevOps pipeline, right? Write down all the steps, fire it up, and forget about it. Outer loop is where security and operations comes into picture. What you will have to do, you will have to pre-create a service connection in your Azure DevOps pipeline that will allow you to connect to your private container registry. Right?
Yeah, that is.
Yes.
Yeah, that
and
is
then
it, yeah.
Whatever Azure pipelines you create, now we are here assuming that you are not building them manually by using Visual Studio or using Eclipse like IDEs. You are doing it all using pipelines, all automated pipelines.
Yeah.
Right? Make sure that you are inside your pipeline, you always mention the same service connection of private container registry.
Right.
Second thing, many organizations, what they do, they put some kind of security rules in their local firewall that will simply not allow anyone to access something like Docker Hub. Getting my point?
Okay.
Right?
I think
but
the
that
second
way,
point.
Yes. And there is one more thing, by the way. In case if you people are using Docker, there is an option available in Docker. You can customize Docker to point to a different default registry.
I think that is the add registry in daemon.json.
Yes, that's what I'm referring to. What will happen is none of your developers will have any idea that they are actually fetching all the container images from a non-public registry. They will be just using Docker pull followed by the container image name. But every time they do that, container images will not be pulled from Docker Hub, but instead will be pulled from their private registry. Okay.
But that is the case of Docker desktop, right? Even in the local. And how about with use in with Azure pipelines in the hosted agents? How we can do that with the hosted agents?
Yeah. For that, what I would recommend is there are two types of agent: Microsoft hosted agents and there are self-hosted agent. If you use self-hosted agent, you will get complete control over them. Like you can actually create a Windows Server 2019 data center with container image. You will get an image on Azure anyways. Use that image, get inside RDP into that image, make necessary customizations to it, and add it to your default pool of pipeline agents.
Right.
Now, whenever any of your developer creates a pipeline and fire it up, right? All the pipelines will execute on this particular default agent, which will not allow them to communicate with Docker Hub at all.
Right. But if with the hosted agents, is there any other criteria? You were speaking about the second point with the firewall setting of the organizations and all. What kind of firewall
setting? Firewall setting. That entirely depends on what kind of firewall you are using, right? You can simply blacklist the docker.io registry URL.
Oh, okay. Like that.
Yeah, like that only.
But other than that, I don't think is there any other way for hosted agents. If you use hosted agents from Microsoft, we cannot tell some condition.
Hosted agent will not have any control. You don't have any control over hosted agent.
Correct.
This is the URL that you need to block. Can you see that? It's docker.io.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Fine. So this was about the container part. Now let's move to the Kubernetes part. Kubernetes is a container orchestrator. And when I say orchestrator, what it actually does, it actually takes care of many things which need to be done manually in case of highly available application. Like, for example, what Kubernetes will do. Kubernetes has lots of controllers. I will just list some of the Kubernetes controllers for you. There is one replica set controller. There is one node controller. There is one service endpoint controller, and so on. There are so many other controllers there. I'm just giving you some examples here. To give you an example, a replica set controller of Kubernetes simply makes sure that your desired replicas is always equal to actual replicas or replicas which are currently running in your Kubernetes cluster. Now, what does it mean? You have deployed an application to Kubernetes and you specified in Kubernetes artifact that I want 3 copies of this particular application running all the time. And because of some reason, out of 3, one instance goes down. Kubernetes already has replica set controller, which is like a, which is like an event loop. It will keep checking whether the desired replicas and actual replicas for all my application is same. If for any reason, if any one of my application desired doesn't match actual, then it will take up necessary operation or it will take up necessary corrective measure. Like if desired is greater than actual, then it will kill one instance. But if actual, it will create new instance. But if actual is greater than desired, then it will kill or eliminate one additional instance. Getting my point? We have node controller. Check the node availability, whether all the nodes are available, whether all the nodes are online. And if a new node has been added to your Kubernetes cluster, it is the one that will actually get it registered, acknowledged. We have got endpoint controller, which will simply, check the backend endpoints, Kubernetes services. Do you know Kubernetes also provides a service discovery for your application, where let's say if you have deployed 3 instances of application, right, with a service, it will make sure that whenever an instance goes up or goes down, it will be properly mapped to that particular service. To give you an example, this is how a particular typical Kubernetes service looks like. There would be a service and there would be, let's say, 3 copies of same application running behind it. So let's say this is application clone number 1. This is application clone number 2 or application copy number 2. And this is application copy number 3. Now, what happens if because of some reason, one of the instance goes down? You know what replica set controller will do? It will create a next clone. Okay. And it will make sure that available count of these particular application clone is always 3. Okay, that is what replica set controller will do. And you know what endpoint controller will do? Endpoint controller will make sure that this is no longer going to take any user request. All the requests will now instead transfer to these nodes. This one will be no longer available. Let's say this is marked as red. Is that clear? So traffic will not be routed to an instance which is down. Instead, it will route all the traffic to instances which are live. That is what endpoint controller will make sure, that all the backend endpoints are active and alive. And if any particular clone goes down, start not responding, then all the traffic will be diverted to some other available clones or other available replicas. We call them replicas, not clones actually in Kubernetes. And this is not just in Azure Kubernetes service. This feature is available in on-premise Kubernetes as well. Yes? Hello?
Yeah, Mahendra. Yeah, okay.
Right? Okay. So Kubernetes as an orchestrator, please remember Kubernetes is not the container runtime. Kubernetes still requires some kind of container runtime to be installed in all your machines. Right now, we all are using Kubernetes with Docker container runtime. But recently, Kubernetes has announced one very interesting news. Kubernetes has started rolling out a new, it's relatively new, it's already there for a couple of years now, but it is going to be a default container runtime now. So Kubernetes is rolling out a new container runtime for all its default installations now. That container runtime is CRIO. Anybody heard about it?
No. So okay. Do you mean to say that they want to be using a Docker?
Yes. Kubernetes no longer now recommend using Docker in your container cluster. But do not worry, it doesn't mean that your Docker container images won't run on CRIO. Only thing is, CRIO is not actually made to be a development tool. You cannot install CRIO in your developer machine and expect them to build container images using CRIO. CRIO can run Docker container images, but cannot create new container images. Getting my point?
Can you repeat this point?
Yeah. What I'm saying is CRIO is a runtime environment. So just as a comparison, if you have Docker, you can build new images, right? Mm-hmm. And you can run existing containers.
All right.
But with CRIO, you cannot build new container images.
Okay.
You can just run the existing images. Now, please remember Docker, Kubernetes, and many other container runtime stack and vendors have actually created a new initiative called, it's not new, it's relatively new, a new initiative called Open Container Initiative, OCI. In short form. OCI actually has its own standard. By the way, all the container images that you are using recently, all those container images are actually following OCI standard. And because they are following OCI standard, it becomes possible for us to build containers using Docker, but run them on CRIO runtime. Is that clear?
Yeah.
Okay, I will explain you why it has to be done. Yes.
But again, that whatever a Docker file and all which you can, that will be remain same, right? We'll be using a...
No. You don't need Docker file in Kubernetes, by the way.
No,
You need container images. Docker file, you will use it only on your developer machine. Getting my point?
Yeah.
You will be using Docker on developer machines. Right? But you will be using CRIO in your runtime environment or your production machines.
Yeah, got it. Yeah.
Right. Okay. So Kubernetes has already initiated a new container runtime. Now I'm saying this is just relatively new. CRIO was there for quite some time, but now Kubernetes has officially declared that CRIO is going to be their default container runtime and not Docker. Okay. Anyways, but there is nothing to be afraid of. Your existing container images that you have built with Docker will continue to work with CRIO runtime as well. I will tell you how exactly a typical node which has Kubernetes up and running actually looks alike. Looks alike means what things need to be installed inside it. Typically, the very first thing that you need to have installed in your Kubernetes node is your container runtime. On top of that, there would be some Kubernetes specific components, like for example, there would be kubelet, and there would be kubeproxy. These are the only two mandatory components other than container runtime which are required for Kubernetes node. Now, do you know one thing? Whatever worker node you have created, let's say your Kubernetes worker node is given 2 CPUs and 4 GB of RAM. Out of that 2 CPU and 4 GB of RAM, you have to allocate certain amount of CPU and RAM to all these three components because they will be running all the time. All these stack or all these applications will be running 24/7 inside your worker node. Getting my point? Now, why Kubernetes has actually started using a newer container runtime? Because it takes extremely less amount of system resources compared to Docker. So what is benefit to us now? It's very simple. Out of whatever system resources we are allocating to our node, right? If certain amount of resources are consumed by these existing component, right? If they consume lesser resource, that means more resources will be made available to our workload, right? So less resource utilization by system component. That is the benefit basically. Or else you can continue using Docker runtime. Okay. Right.
So my question is, what is the version of this Kubernetes rollout upgrade? Like it's 1.19 or
1.9? 1.20 onwards. Yeah. 1.20 onward, it is CRIO. But please remember, it doesn't mean that you cannot use Docker. You can still use Docker in 1.20 as well. Okay. You can still use it, but Kubernetes strongly recommend not to use it, because if you use it, only thing is more system resources will be used by these components. See, Kubernetes have control over how much resources or how to optimize kubelet and how to optimize kubeproxy. Make sure that they consume lesser resource. But Docker is a third-party tool for Kubernetes team, right?
Right.
They cannot force Docker team to make sure that their engine consumes lesser CPU and RAM. They can't do that. But
CRIO cannot initiate a container, right? So even if it pulls also this images.
No, it can initiate container. Only thing is it cannot build container images.
Okay. It cannot build. Understood.
Right, okay, yeah, I understood.
I think I got it wrong while listening. So it can run.
It can run, it cannot build. See, I have written it here.
Right, I understood.
Okay, now, so Kubernetes is this. Now, on-premise Kubernetes and managed Kubernetes, the difference is, in on-premise Kubernetes, the bigger challenge is Kubernetes master or Kubernetes control plane. Kubernetes cluster actually looks like this. You have master nodes, or what we call a control plane. Then you have got workers, let's say worker pool 1, and you might have worker pool 2. Now there could be many reasons why you should use two pools. Like, for example, a very common approach: worker pool 1 is Linux workers and worker pool 2 is for Windows machines, right? Okay. Now, in case if you are deploying an on-premise Kubernetes, you will have to also make sure that your on-premise Kubernetes is highly available. Now, somebody just mentioned that their on-premise Kubernetes are just one master node. Do you know what is disadvantage of having just one master node in on-premise Kubernetes cluster?
The whole application depends on only one master. So if it have some fault, of course. Everything will be
if
gone.
Your only Kubernetes master goes down, you lose connectivity to your Kubernetes cluster.
But again, like Mahendra, we can have a cluster of master also, right? Master cluster. Right?
Yes, that's what I said. You can have highly available set of Kubernetes control plane, where instead of just one machine acting as a master, you will have three machines acting as a master. The highly available Kubernetes cluster setup recommend having three machines as Kubernetes master, or setting up three Kubernetes master instead of just one. Sorry. So you will have three copies of it: master 1, master 2, master 3.
So it will not work as a load balancer, it will work as a high availability only, right?
Yeah, load balancer anyway, you have to set it up manually. Now that is another challenge. It's not just enough to just create three copies of it. You also have to set up a load balancer for it.
Okay. Mahendra, just one question. Sorry to disturb. Since like you told that with a new flavor of Kubernetes, like I'm just talking about older one where we used to install the Docker on top of that. We used to install kubelet, kubeadm and kubectl. So in the new things like which you have shown, like what we need to install, like if you are not using a Docker.
Remaining all the things are same. You still need kubelet, you still need kubeproxy, and you still need master components, other master components in Kubernetes. See,
so from there we'll get
this
a CR.
Is only for worker nodes. Please remember the components that I have listed are only for worker node. If you are setting up Kubernetes master, then there are lot many other additional components that you need there, right?
So means like what normally we have done is like till kubelet, kubectl, and kubeadmin, I have installed all the component on master worker. Now this will be the extra one if you are going for CRO, right, on the worker node.
Yes.
Okay.
But see, if you install CRIO, there is no Docker runtime required.
Got it.
And there is one more thing, by the way. To be frank, installing Kubernetes manually is a very time-consuming thing, and nobody actually does it manually. There are some kind of automated tools available. Like, for example, I have a video recorded a couple of months back where I have set up Kubernetes cluster, on-premise Kubernetes cluster using Terraform and Ansible.
Can you share that link?
I will share the link later with you in the chat window. Okay. So,
and one more thing, like, do you have any document for this, like the worker node with CRIO installation?
No, I don't have any document right now, but you can get it from the Kubernetes documentation page, the official documentation page. It's very easy, actually. I will just show you. It's kubernetes.io/docs. This is official Kubernetes documentation. Okay. And you can just search for CRIO directly here. Here it is. This gives you a lot of internal technical information about CRIO. I'll share the link.
That's great. Thank you.
Right. Okay. And always refer to official documentation link. Do not go with any blog or something. This will give you more detailed information, actually. Okay. Now, going ahead now, Azure makes deploying Kubernetes a lot more easier. Manage Kubernetes, that means. High availability of Kubernetes master plane is now responsibility handled by or taken care of by Microsoft. Microsoft will make sure that your Kubernetes master is highly available. You just have to deploy one or more worker pools. To give you an example of that, I already have created a script. Let me just go back here. Here in this script, I've already created a script. Here I'm going to create a Kubernetes cluster and ACR. ACR means container registry. And this is my AKS, Azure Kubernetes Service. By just running this script, I will make sure that all these resources are created. What I'll do is, I'll just fire the script now, because anyway, resource creation takes time. This will create both my ACR and AKS. ACR creation won't take much time. I guess it should have been done already. Okay, not yet. Okay, it's still doing it. It's creating the necessary service principles. Okay. Anyway, I'll explain the Azure Kubernetes Service now quickly to you. Azure Kubernetes Service actually makes sure that you get highly available Kubernetes cluster, which is entirely managed by Microsoft. So the control plane is managed by Microsoft. Remember, when I say managed by Microsoft, that means you will never get any direct access to your control plane. You cannot RDP or SSH into Kubernetes master. Getting my point? You can only get access to Kubernetes API server. And you know, this access is also provided to you using the usual HTTPS protocol via HTTPS. Other than that, you don't get any access to control plane. But for workers, you get complete access. You can choose how many worker nodes you want to deploy. Okay. So this would be managed by customer, that is us. You will be charged, or Microsoft will actually calculate your resource consumption or resource usage only on this part, not on this part. This is entirely provided free of cost to you by Microsoft. This you will be charged for. Let me check. Okay, looks like my Kubernetes cluster is about to run now. My container registry is created. Let me show you that. This is my Azure container registry. This is a private container registry. One primary benefit of container registry, private container registry, is that you can control who can access this container registry and who cannot access this container registry. Getting it? You can even integrate it with Azure Active Directory. So you can even create users and roles in Active Directory and grant them access to this container registry. You can even make someone only have pull access to container registry, but no push access. Or you can have someone have only push access, but no pull access. Okay. You will notice right now there are no repositories as such. That's great. Now, so this part was about the container registry part, Kubernetes service part. Any question on Kubernetes service so that we will move on to Azure pipelines then?
Mahendra, just one question. It's not related, yeah. But since yeah. like we have talked that we don't have the access on the master node, right? It will be totally yeah. controlled by the Azure.
Yes.
So my question is like there is a component called HCD, right? It's etcd.
Yes, yes.
So database. So like if we want to customize that, like suppose if you want to have our own database, like maybe MongoDB, something like that, how can we do that?
Actually, Microsoft allows you to create your own Kubernetes cluster, not AKS, but self-managed container cluster as well. There is something called ACS engine available from Microsoft, Azure Container Service Engine, where you can create your own template. You can specify what backend database you want to use by your Kubernetes control plane and everything. But then it will no longer be PaaS. It will be then infrastructure as a service kind of cluster.
So then they will charge us for that particular storage, like yes. how much
then
we're storing.
You will be charged for everything, for the storage, for the master VM, and for everything. See, that so, this is a limitation of using PaaS.
Can you just repeat the service, please? I need to note it down.
Yeah, yeah, I'll show you. You can actually get it from Azure Quick Start template as well, in case if you want to do it on your own.
So what do you suggest, like whether we should go for it or like it should be totally should be given to the Azure team?
It's actually much better to continue with the PaaS service which is available, unless there is some strong reason why you do not want etcd, which is managed by Microsoft, and instead of that, why do you want some other alternate data store, for example.
Okay. Thank you, Mahendra.
Yeah. This is called ACR Engine. Okay, we don't have it here. Sorry, not ACR, ACS. Here it is. Azure Container Service Engine. You will have to download, install the binary file. And then using this binary file, you will have to create a template. Inside that template, you specify how you want your cluster to be set up, right? And here you can customize everything. Once you create the cluster, you can even just use ACS Engine Deploy to deploy that on cloud. Is that clear?
Yeah, that's helpful. Thank you, Mahendra. Right?
So I will just share the link with you. This you can use. But remember, when you use this, everything is managed and controlled by you, okay? And Microsoft will charge you for everything, for all master node as well as worker node. Microsoft will not look at it as a Kubernetes cluster. It will just look at it as a single resource group having bunch of VMs, network, and data storage. So every service will be charged accordingly. Okay. But as a benefit, you get complete control. Please remember, in case if you are using IaaS mode or infrastructure mode for Kubernetes, it is recommended that you should have at least a smaller team to take care of your Kubernetes cluster, IT support team. People who know how to manage Kubernetes cluster, like probably if required, how to increase and decrease master nodes, or how to take, let's say, a backup of etcd data store, or how to troubleshoot the connectivity errors with API server, right? How to add a new node into an existing cluster, or how to take down a node for a time being for maybe some kind of maintenance activity and re-register it back. Okay.
Thank you.
Right. Okay. Azure pipeline, our main concept or our main topic. Azure pipeline is a CI/CD workflow tool. Azure pipeline is actually part of Azure DevOps, but Azure DevOps doesn't actually force you to use all its features. You can just register for Azure DevOps and use only pipeline, or you can use it along with Azure repos, Azure board, Azure artifact, Azure test suite, and so on. Azure pipeline provides you easy to set up CI/CD workflows with lots of community extensions. For actually running your pipeline, there are lot many tools available. Sorry, there are lot many agent types available. Now, to understand this concept better, I will draw it here. Azure pipeline is a service. Now, it depends whether you are using Azure DevOps or you are using TFS. Have you heard about TFS, by the way?
Yeah, we are using
TFS that. Is an on-premise version, and Azure DevOps is a SaaS version of the same tool. By the way, it's no longer called TFS now. It's got rebranded as Azure DevOps Server. Okay. Now, Azure pipeline as a service, in case if you use, uses one or more pipeline agents to actually run all your tasks. So you will have lot many pipeline agents. Now, when I say pipeline agents, or simply say agent, these agents can be either a bare metal machine or a virtual machine, or they could be containers as well. A Docker container can also be used as a pipeline agent, by the way. So there are three options. Either it would be a bare metal, or it could be a virtual machine, or it could be a container. It could be any of these three. Now, again, there are two options available in Azure pipeline. Either you can use pipeline agent which are managed by or taken care of by Microsoft. Microsoft will actually host them somewhere on their cloud platform and make them available to you. You don't get any access to them. You cannot just RDP into those pipeline agent or SSH into them, add and remove some kind of software or reconfigure them. You get absolutely no control over them. And guess what? Pipeline agents, Microsoft hosted pipeline agents, are shared agents. Shared means right now that particular VM is building your project. But after your project build is over, it will delete all your project related artifact from the given pipeline agent, clean it, and keep it ready for some other user. Getting my point?
Can you just explain once again, like?
I'll explain.
It's confusing.
What basically Microsoft does, Microsoft has lots of virtual machines or containers, or maybe combination of both of them, running there on their own private cloud as agent, right? Now, whenever, like, let's take an example. There are two people, developer number one who has Azure DevOps subscription. Now, for a time being here, we will take an example here. This particular user is using free Azure DevOps subscription. It could be paid subscription as well, doesn't matter because things are same for both of them. So this guy here is using Azure DevOps subscription, and he has recently started a new build, right? Now what Microsoft will do, as soon as he asks Azure DevOps or Azure Pipeline to start building his project, what Azure DevOps will do, it will check out of number of virtual machines which are available there in an VM agent pool, it will pick one VM, right? Pass all the artifacts to that VM and let that machine build project developed by developer number one. Is that clear? After build is successful or after build finish, after build is finished, all the artifacts will be transferred to developer one. So Microsoft Azure Pipeline will transfer all the agent log, artifacts, everything it will hand over to developer one. And you know what it will do next? It will now, next, it will wait for another user to create similar build. So there is a possibility that there are two different users who are actually using same build agent. And do not worry, this is completely safe to use. You know why it is completely safe? Because before, after every use, Microsoft will, you know, so-called sanitize that particular VM. Rather, what Microsoft actually does nowadays, it doesn't actually allocate virtual machine. It creates container instead. Getting my point? It okay. Run all your build tasks inside a container. And after your build is finished, the container will be deleted. And when another user starts another build, a fresh container, a fresh VM will be provisioned for that particular user. Getting my point?
So the other developer might be from the different project. He may not be using the same
different project
pipeline.
Or even from the different organization as well.
Okay.
Right? But do not worry. After the build is finished, all the build-related artifacts and information is deleted from that virtual machine. Is that clear?
Okay. So right. Just one question, like, is it not like if the same developer, suppose like for which he has triggered a first one, he comes again and trigger the same thing, will it not take a time, means like time consuming, because it has to do the full process once again?
Every build will be considered as a fresh build if you use Microsoft hosted build agent.
Okay.
So you can't say that earlier it took 10 minutes for my application to build because it has to download all the necessary dependencies. Second time you build it, again it's going to take equal amount of time.
Okay, I thought like it should take the delta changes and should work and it will be faster. Okay.
If you want something like that, use self-hosted build agent then.
Okay, yeah, thank you.
Right? See, there are options given by Microsoft. This will make sure, please remember, after every build, everything is deleted from the build agent because you are using it in a shared mode, basically. Okay. Now.
Thank you, Mendra.
Yeah, welcome. Now, what you have to prepare here is a document called pipeline. Pipeline as a document. You can actually create a new format of Azure DevOps pipeline. We call them YAML pipeline, which can be checked into a Git repository directly. So what does pipeline contain? Pipeline simply contains steps. What you want your build agent to do. Is that clear?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, so you can choose from multiple different types of agent. Microsoft Azure DevOps or Azure Pipelines actually support all three operating systems. It supports Windows, it supports macOS, and it supports Linux. As far as Linux is concerned, you can actually free to use any Linux distribution of your choice. But if you go with Microsoft hosted build agent, you will get only Ubuntu Linux. Is that clear? In self-hosted, you have multiple choices. You can even use OpenSUSE, Red Hat, CentOS, and so on. Same way, for Mac OS X, you will get last two version of Mac OS X in Microsoft hosted build agent. Okay. For Windows, again same. You will automatically get Windows Server 2019 or Windows Server 2012 or 2016. 16 would be there, right? Automatically selected for you. But if it is self-hosted, you have got much wider scope over there. Number three, Azure pipelines, you do not have to always create pipeline from an empty template. In my demo, after a couple of minutes, I'll show you the demo. Demo itself will take another 40 minutes, I guess. In that demo, I'm going to use empty template, but you do not have to always choose empty template. You have got lots of ready-to-use template that can make your pipeline creation a lot more easier. Azure Pipelines is free for public project. Now, when I say free, there are certain restrictions or limitations are there. But anyways, public project, it is free. For private project also, you can create it for free, but with little more restrictions. The sample application which I'm going to deploy here, I will explain what it is. In this demo or in this session, I'm going to deploy a Java-based Spring Boot application on my Kubernetes cluster. And this application is a simple two-tier application with one REST API and with one MySQL database. And for this application, I have already pre-created all the Kubernetes component. Let me take you to my GitHub repository now. Here we are, GitHub. Mahendra Shinde / Spring REST Docker Compose. Originally, I created this in one of my Spring Boot session for explaining Docker Compose, but later I extended it to use with Kubernetes as well. You will notice one thing, there are two subfolders, API app, which contains my Java-based REST API. This is a Maven project, and this is a database. Can you see for database, I have just two files. One is Docker file, and second, the SQL file. This actually contains DML and DQL for sample database, and this is my Docker file. You can see it here. Then, these are my Kubernetes artifact. Everything is pre-created. Like for example, this is my application deployment file. This is my application service deployment file where I have specified that I want my sample service to be a load balancer type service to make it accessible from outside. And I also have the configuration map, config map, where I'll be keeping my database username, password, or database service URL, everything. Okay. So that's my sample application. My URL I have already shared with you. This is what my sample pipeline is going to do. Can you see the entire architecture on my screen?
Yes.
Number one, in my this particular demo, I'm going to create two different pipelines. Number one, as your CI pipeline or build pipeline, which will simply download the source code. Inside those source code, in some of the files, I have left some placeholders. It will replace those placeholders with values from Azure pipeline variables. Then, after running through all these steps, it at the end, on the success, it will have container images pushed to container registry and modified KTS artifact or Kubernetes artifact ready. Just for a change, let me just go back to this branch called AKS branch. AKS CD branch, and let me show you this Docker Compose file. Can you see the placeholder on line number 7?
Yes.
Right. And similarly, there is a placeholder on line number 27. I'm not mentioning my container image name here, because one very simple reason, I want my container image name to be calculated or put here by my Azure DevOps pipeline. I'll be doing this dynamically from Azure DevOps pipeline. Same way, if you look at my Kubernetes deployment file, there are also placeholders can be found here. Can you see the same placeholder here as well?
Yeah.
Line number 18. Okay. Let's see now. I've already run the script, I guess. Let me check. if my script execution is over. Yes, my script execution is over. Let me show you how many clusters I do have right now. If I do AKS list, I already have this cluster ready with me. Let me just check if the cluster is configured here. Anyway, it's not required actually. Wait a second, looks like this is an older one. Yeah, this is an older one. Kubectl config delete context. Oh, sorry, need to switch. Okay, now there is only one context. I can just download the fresh credentials now. AZAKS get hyphen credentials. This command, this is actually I'm using Azure CLI, cross-platform CLI on my local machine. Get credential for my cluster. My cluster name is this is Kubernetes service. My AKS01 is my cluster name. By the way, there is an easier way to get the credential. If you click on the connect button here, it will actually give you the entire command right here. Can you see that? Second line. AZAKS get credential with resource group name and cluster name. This will allow me to connect to my Kubernetes cluster from my local machine. Done. Can you see how many nodes are there in my Kubernetes cluster right now?
Yeah, three.
There are three. But you will notice one thing. It does not show me any master node. Master node is not shown anywhere. Okay. It only shows me the worker node. Okay. All these are my worker nodes, by the way. There are three of them. Anyways, no issues. Going ahead, I will now create my required project. What I will do is, I will sign up on dev.azure.com. You can create your own Azure DevOps subscription for free. You just need a personal or office Microsoft ID. I will recommend you create a personal email account @outlook.com, @hotmail.com and so on, and then use it for this project. Here I'll go with new project and I'll just give it a name, Cube Demo. I want to create a new public project. So that once project is created, I will be able to share my project URL with all of you, and you should be able to explore my project. Public project means anyone will be able to access my project. Obviously, you will not be able to do any edit operation. You will be only given reader access to my project. Now, Azure DevOps already has a feature called repos. What I will do, my current Azure repo is empty. Let me import my GitHub repository here. Click on import and then copy paste the GitHub URL here. This GitHub URL. Repository URL. This is my Azure DevOps, sorry, this is my GitHub repository. I'm just going to import my entire sample application repository into my Azure DevOps repo. It's here now. Let's go to the pipeline. And as I said, I will be creating two pipelines here. In phase one, I'll be building and publishing the container image. And phase two, we will be pushing them to container registry later. These are the steps I'm going to do. I've already done the import. Now I'm going to create an empty template with these many tasks. Let's see. Creating a pipeline. here I'll be creating a pipeline which is classic editor pipeline. I do not want YAML pipeline as of now. I want to use the classic pipeline. Classic pipeline is easy to create, and there is one more benefit, by the way. YAML pipeline is only available when we use Git as a version control system. If you use something like SVN or TFVC, you cannot use YAML pipeline. For repo, I'm going to use AKS-CD branch of my Cube demo repository now. Empty job. Any questions?
No. Just one question, Mahinder, like maybe at a later I can ask, but since like you have shown us one placeholder, right, for the image. So in the live in a live like project, is it recommendable to have that?
Yes, it is highly recommended. You want your image names to be dynamically populated. Okay, you can do one thing then. You can keep one part of image static and one part dynamic. Like for example, a container image is typically written in this format. Okay, syntax is you need to begin with registry URL, / repository name, / the image name, then colon, and then you write tag. That is version number, right?
Yeah.
So what you can do, or what is I have seen many people do it for their production workload, is that they do something like this. This might be your container registry name, let's say. / application name, colon, and then here they use variable only for this part. You know what is benefit of using this syntax? This part, the first part of image name remains same. Your pipeline only updates this part. Okay. Is that clear?
Okay.
Yeah. Makes Most sense. Commonly people use build ID here or build number. Okay. So that I'll tell you what is benefit of this. What if you have to roll back to a previous version of your application? Your latest version of application has some kind of bug. To roll back, just change the build number or just change the version tag, and your Kubernetes cluster will deploy the last successful built application instead. Wait a second, I'm also using a self-hosted build agent instead of using Microsoft hosted build agent. I'm going to use self-hosted build agent. I need to launch that. Anyways, let me show you the pipeline now. The very first task I'm going to add, can you see the plus button here?
Yes.
I'm adding a new task. Let me first replace the token or use a task called replace token. Replace token is a very interesting tool that allows us to find a configuration file, find the placeholders in that configuration file, and replace those placeholders with variables we have got in our Kubernetes cluster. So let's do one thing. Let's go to the variables and create new variable. One variable I'm going to add here is app image. And in app image, let's say I want my app colon dollar round bracket build dot build ID. Is that clear?
Yeah.
So whatever API app I'm building, I want this image name. Same way for database, I want database image to be given name mydb colon dollar round bracket build dot build ID. Sorry, I just made a mistake here. This should be closing round bracket. So this is what I'm doing here. I'm just setting these two parameters here. These two variables, sorry. Now let's go back to the task. Replace token is a very interesting step. Let's say I want to replace tokens in Docker Compose file. Docker Compose is basically the file which contains all the instructions for building my image. Target files which I'm referring to here is, I'll just say I'm referring to docker-compose.yml. You can specifically write name of that YAML file, but let me check or let me confirm if my file name is exactly matching. No, it's not matching. It should be YAML, not YML. otherwise build will fail. So this is the file I want to replace. Inside this file, there are some placeholders. Let's go to the advanced section. And in advanced section, can you see the token prefix and token suffix?
Yes.
The placeholders, I'm using double underscore as a placeholder suffix and placeholder prefix. So you will have to update it here. Double underscore for beginning, double underscore for end. Please remember, it all depends like how you have written those placeholders here. In case if you have written something like dollar curly bracket, dollar round bracket, put those prefix and suffix values here. Is that clear?
Yeah.
Okay.
One more thing.
Yes. Yes.
Just config
you want to see.
Yeah. There was some auto.
Yeah. File encoding. This is for file encoding. This is like, you know, text files could be written in UTF format or ASCII format.
Okay, right? It's
about that. In case if you want to manually write, you can see this. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, we have next task, which is Docker Compose task. So we will do this now. Can you see there is a step for Docker Compose? Docker Compose basically allows us to build a multi-container application easily instead of using Dockerfile. Please remember, you might be surprised why we are using Docker Compose. This Docker Compose is internally making a reference to Dockerfile. Can you see line number 6, build API app?
Yeah.
What it's going to do, it's going to get inside the API app directory and then it will pick up Dockerfile from there to build the necessary container image. Okay. Now, here, fortunately or unfortunately, there are some steps are missing. Now, what steps are missing in here? I'll explain. Here, we need to provide our Azure subscription and Azure container registry details. So let me provide that. I already have linked my Azure subscription here. I just need to authorize it. To authorize it, I will have to log in into my Azure subscription like this. Here it is. Then I will enter the password and this will authorize me automatically. By default, it will give co-admin privileges to it. Then container registry. Right now, I have only one container registry created and its name is MyACR101. Let's see if my container registry is available in here. Here it is. Docker Compose file, I need to just pick it up from here. This is the Docker Compose file. And this is the project name, qualify image name, and command I want to use here is build command. I want to build all container images. Similarly, I need another task. Can you see an option called clone task?
Yes.
I need another command, but this time it's Docker Compose push. Push is used for pushing image to container registry and build is used to just create new container image. Now what I'm going to do here, rest everything will be same, only this command instead of build, I will be using push. Wait a second, I need to make one small change. I need to make sure that my command is written in small letters. So this is build and this is push. Is that clear?
Yep.
Wait a second, I guess I need to log in into my Azure VM right now. I have not set it to run automatically. I have set the pipeline agent to run manually. Here it is. Oh. Okay, fine. Now I'm inside the build agent. This is my self-hosted build agent. And I'm going to launch my build agent using run.sh script. You will notice now my build agent will be initialized and it will be waiting for a new build, basically. Right, listening for job. Now my private build agent or self-hosted build agent is ready to take all the requests from my Azure pipeline. Let's do one thing. Can you see the save and queue? This is my phase one. Okay. I'm just going to try, check if it is able to build and push container images to ACR from right from here. It's already in a queue. Fine, it's waiting for the build agent here. Wait a second, I made a mistake actually. I have run this on Microsoft hosted build agent, not on self-hosted one. I do not know how much time it will take because currently Azure pipeline is having some kind of live site incident, and because of that there might be delay. But looks like this time I'm lucky. This build agent is not running, or this build is not running on my self-hosted agent. It's running on Microsoft hosted agent, by the way. Reason why I created self-hosted agent because of this part. Wait a second. Service app image, it should be string. Fine, I'll just build it with my self-hosted agent. Run new. I'll do one thing, instead of using this agent specification, I will select here private build agent. Can you see the agent pool I have selected default? Default agent pool means it will divert that request to this particular build agent. See, it has showing a message running job. Yeah, it's already queued now. I have pre-configured it to run all the Docker steps. Okay, it has done the replace token part as well. Wait a second, one of the variable name didn't match. Let me check if my variable name is correct. What should be the name? API image, okay, and DB image. I guess I have written a wrong variable name in my project, and because of that, it has failed. Edit pipeline, variables, and it's not app image, it's API image. Save and queue on default agent pool. Okay, it's going to fire another run now. Okay. Next run, second run. Okay, it has done the replace token part. It has done the Docker compose part now. Build is completely done. It's now doing the push operation now. Can you see the line number 11 here? Push refers to repository myacr101 azurecr.io/mydb. Do you remember where did I mention this MyDB word? Any idea?
In variables?
Yeah. It was in the variable. Okay, it was in my pipeline variable. Okay, it has done this. Let me just go and check quickly in my container registry. Container registry. That's my ACR101. And inside my Azure Container Registry, let me check my repositories here. Okay, looks like only database image is uploaded. Application image is not yet uploaded. So we'll just wait for the pipeline to finish that. Okay, done. Can you see both my app and MyDB now? This is MyDB and this is my app. Both are now deployed. So my continuous build phase number one is complete. What all things did I use in build phase? Number one, I used empty template. On that empty template, I use replace token, then Docker compose build, Docker compose push. This will allow me to build and push my container image to container registry. Any question on this?
Mahendra, like, regarding the token, can we see that what the token was generated? Like, is it like a GUID or something like that?
No, I can show you that. I can show you that. Just give me a minute. Okay. Let me just take you to the pipeline here. This is my pipeline. Just need to open this in edit mode. Yeah. Oh, sorry. For showing that, I just have to look at the logs.
So this has nothing to do with the JWT token or the thing.
No, this is not like JWT token. This is a very simple token part. Even though it says token, it is simply replacing just a placeholder.
Okay.
It's like replacing a placeholder.
And it will be a unique one.
Yeah.
Every time.
Right. But it's not generating any new value as such. What it is doing, whatever value you have specified in variable section, it will simply use that value there. Getting my point?
Okay.
And by the way, just for you, because we are using private build agent, we get this benefit here. I can actually show you where these files are in my private build agent. Let's go to the source folder. Can you see here Docker Compose file?
Yeah.
See, this is what it has done.
Okay, okay. Yeah, got it.
Is that clear? This is what it has done here. Okay, fine. And this is possible because we are using private agent. On Microsoft agent, I won't be able to do this. Okay?
Okay.
Let's run this again. Fine. So this is how I done the first phase where I did build the container images and push them to container registry. Now phase two, update Kubernetes artifact with image tags. Now, let me tell you one small challenge that we will face here. Now, the challenge that we will face here is that while we were using Docker Compose task, Docker Compose task was able to add container registry URL before container image name properly. But when I tried to do that for Kubernetes artifact task, it was not happening. So what I did, I manually inserted it into my variable. So very first thing I'm going to do now is I'm going to change my variables again. So this is the pipeline. I'll just go and edit this. And in this pipeline, in my variables, let me replace these variables, or let's just add a new variable first, ACR. Here, I'm going to use my actual container registry URL. This is my container registry URL. Can you see that? Login server. Here it is. Then I'm going to modify these variables to use ACR name as a prefix. Please remember, if it was only Docker Compose, I do not have to do this manually. Docker Compose is anyway adding ACR login URL automatically to my image name. But when I do that for Kubernetes artifact, that was not happening, and I have to do it manually in that case. Okay. Now, there is one more step I need to add now that will simply do a replace token now, but this time on Kubernetes artifacts. Replace tokens. Please remember, it is more like replace placeholders. Root directory this time is this, ktest deployment. Can you see that? Hello? And these are only two files. Yeah, there are actually these many files, but I just have to modify, or I just have to find tokens only in these two files, app deploy and db deploy. How will I do that? I'll use a placeholder here. Is that clear?
Yeah.
Do you know what this token will do? This will replace, or this will find tokens only in those files where file name ends with hyphen deploy.yml. Is that clear? That means it will modify only app deploy and db deploy, and it will ignore all the other YAML files.
Okay.
Okay. And then the same advanced part. In advanced part, here I'm going to just provide the prefix and suffix, and you know what value is needed. Double underscore. Is that clear?
Yep.
Then Let's do one more step. After this step, what I need next is I need to copy the files. Next I need to do is copy files. Copy files from source folder to target folder. Now what files we need to copy? Okay, we need to copy all the files from this k8s deployment folder. Can you see that? And here I'm just going to say that I want to copy all the files which have .yaml extension. Is that clear?
Will it take YAML or it will be YML?
No, no. It all depends on what files you have created. To give you an example, in k8s deployment directory, all my files have YAML extension.
Okay.
See, this replace token or this step doesn't care whether they are YAML or YML. Okay, it will just do the complete, check on that. Here we need artifact staging directory. This I will use. I will explain you later why we are doing this. Okay. Right now, I just want to copy this to artifact staging directory, which is a temporary directory on your build agent. After this, a final step in the integration pipeline, which is publish artifact. Here it is, publish build artifacts. And in publish build artifact, what we have to do, no change. It will simply automatically take this build artifact staging directory, and whatever is there in artifact staging directory, it will copy it to Azure Pipeline's own private storage called Dropbox, or we just call it Drop. You name it something else as well, no issues. I'll explain you why it is to be done. Remember what I told you in pipelines or in pipeline agent, after your build is completed, it automatically deletes everything from the pipeline agent. But we don't want everything to be deleted. We want certain files to be retained, Kubernetes files to be retained. So we need to copy them outside build agent into some safe place so that we can reuse them later in our continuous delivery pipeline. Getting my point? Hello?
Yeah.
Now my phase two is over. I will just save and queue it again, and this time again on my default agent pool. Now this time again it's going to do a build, again it's going to do a publish, but this time what it will do additional. Wait a second, is it running? Yeah, started running now. What additional thing it will do? It will modify the Kubernetes artifacts. Okay. Please remember, this one will work for on-premise Kubernetes as well and for managed Kubernetes as well. Rather, it doesn't matter where your Kubernetes cluster is, because we are not actually trying to deploy anything. We are just making some minor changes to our Kubernetes YAML files, which can be deployed anywhere. Is that right?
Yep.
Can you see it's saying one artifact produced? Let's check what artifact it has produced. It has produced a folder called Drop, which contains these files, the configuration files, service, deployment files, and so on. All these Kubernetes artifacts are now ready. Please remember, it is also possible to create one single .yaml file which contains all these things, application, database, configuration, and everything. I personally do not like it. Okay, but it's your choice whether to keep everything in one single monolith YAML file or to create multiple YAML files. Okay. Now my build part is over. Any question on build part right now?
No.
This part is common for all kind of Kubernetes deployment. In phase three, now this is going to be our last phase, which will take another 10 minutes now. Not even 10 minutes, just 5 minutes. In this step now, we are going to create another type of pipeline in Azure DevOps, which is called release pipeline, where we will connect it with our Kubernetes cluster, and then we will simply do the deployment. Do you know how we actually deploy anything in Kubernetes? Using kubectl command. Let me show you that. I will now just go back to pipelines. And can you see under pipelines, there is a separate option available for releases? Can you see that? Release pipeline is actually used for continuous delivery or continuous deployment. I'm going to create a new release pipeline. This is my final part of this. And here, I'm going to choose empty job. This is going to be my dev environment, let's say. For build artifact, I need to pick up build artifact from my last successful build. But by the way, what is there in my build artifact now? Anyone?
The YAML file.
The YAML file. Kubernetes YAML files are my build artifact now. And my continuous delivery pipeline requires those artifacts. Next. Dev stage. In dev stage, I'm going to add a step now, which is kubectl step. Can you see this?
Yep.
Now, one very interesting part here, you can use it to deploy your Azure DevOps application, or you can use it to deploy your application to any Kubernetes cluster, not just AKS. In order to do that, you need to provide Kubernetes service connection. Here, what you have to do is, you have to either provide a kubeconfig file, entire content of kubeconfig, you can copy paste it here. Where to find kubeconfig? Generally, it should be on your Kubernetes master node. Is that clear? If you want to see my kubeconfig, I can show you from here. Here it is. This is my kubeconfig. Can you see that? You can just copy paste entire content of this file here, right?
So or but Mahendra, yes. Sorry, yeah. But this kubeconfig, it will be on the master, right? So if yes. It is on Azure, I think we don't have the access on the master node, right?
Right, you don't have access to master node, but then what you can do, you can run az-aks get credential command on your local machine to get the credential file, right? Fine. And then copy paste it here. But yeah, actually, even that is not required. You can simply connect your Azure subscription directly here. Wait a second, even that is not required. I can just select here Azure Resource Manager. Can you see the option?
Yeah.
And then available Azure service connection. Here it is, already authorized. Here we can choose the resource group and the Kubernetes cluster name. This way you do not need kubeconfig file. Is that clear?
Okay.
Please remember this option is only for Azure Kubernetes service, managed AKS. In case if you are using infrastructure service, or in case if you are using on-premise Kubernetes, then this option will not work. Is that clear?
Just like out of the box question, since we are using AKS, can we use EKS and like AWS, Google?
Yes, in case if you want to use EKS, Elastic Kubernetes Service, or GKE, Google Kubernetes Engine, there are extensions available.
Where can we see it if you don't mind it? Can you just, or is it not covered? Is it?
No, it's not covered, but at least I can show you where you can find Azure DevOps, what we can call it, marketplace. Can you see the shopping bags here?
Yeah, got it.
Just click on the shopping bags, browse marketplace. Wait a second, I just have to open it in a new tab. I'm not showing you how to use them, I'm just showing you how to find them. Oh, wait a second. Just search for Kubernetes and you might find an options here. Like I can see here, there is an option for DigitalOcean Kubernetes, but there is no one for Google. Anyway, you can do that. In that case, use Kubernetes service connection and manually provide kubeconfig file. Is that clear?
Yeah, okay.
That will always work. Fine. So once we provide all the necessary details about how to provide connection to Kubernetes, there is one more small thing that you need to do. Can you see a switch for cluster admin credential?
Yeah.
Please remember this is required, because now on AKS, if you clear this checkbox, you will get only reader permission. That means your pipeline will fail to deploy anything new, because you are granting your Azure DevOps pipeline only read access. But if you use this checkbox, it will give you admin access as well, or write access as well. Is that clear?
So this will be a part of the security, right? Like
This is part of security, actually. Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, next, with kubectl, what kubectl command you want to use? Now you can see kubectl has lot many commands. One I want to use is kubectl apply with configuration files. And guess what? I want to apply all these files, right? So what I'll do, I will not select any individual file, but instead I will select the folder name, which is drop. Now, in Kubernetes, kubectl apply space hyphen f, and instead of file, if you provide directory name, you know what kubectl will do? It will apply all the .yaml files in your directory. Is that clear? Or you can specify an individual file name as well. Do that and you are good to go. Is that clear?
Okay.
In case, if required, please remember, right now, my AKS cluster and my ACR container registry both are running on Azure, and they both are already attached or connected to each other. Let's take an hypothetical scenario. You are using Azure Kubernetes service, but your container registry is not on Azure. What if you are using ECR or GCR, Google Container Registry or Elastic Container Registry? In that case, you need to manually select your container registry credentials here. Is that clear? Hello?
Yeah, got it.
But, yeah, right now I do not have to do this, because both my container registry and Kubernetes cluster are on same cloud and they are already integrated with each other. So I can ignore it. But otherwise, you have to provide the secret details here. Last time I did this, I got a query from someone like what to do if container registry is hosted somewhere else. Okay, so there is an option available for secret here. Anyways, that is the only task which is needed in release pipeline. Getting my point?
Okay.
Let me save this and let's run the release pipeline. By the way, there is one more interesting stuff here. Can you see the lightning bolt?
Yeah.
It allows you to enable continuous delivery. Now, what is continuous deployment trigger? It means every time your build pipeline run, after build pipeline successfully finish, you want delivery pipeline, deployment pipeline to automatically run as well. Okay, I want that.
Okay.
Let's save this. And I will not create a new release immediately. I will instead go to my build pipeline. Okay, this is my build pipeline. Let me just edit the build pipeline. And do you know about continuous integration trigger in build pipeline as well, under trigger section? What is benefit of this? Any idea? Anyone? Any idea what it will do? Wait a second. I just have to make sure that it's using default build agent. What it will actually do is, every time anyone makes any changes to my repository here, the change will automatically trigger a new build. After successful new build, it will automatically trigger a new deployment. Getting my point? Let me show you that. It could be anything, right? Like, for example, let me go to this README file, and somewhere in README file, let me just add some comment. Okay, and commit this. I made some changes to my, wait a second, not this branch actually. Right now we are not working on master branch. We are working on AKS CD branch. So I should make changes in AKS CD branch only. Commit. This will trigger a new commit. This will trigger a new pipeline now. Let's go to the pipeline. Can you see pipeline is already in progress, the clock-like symbol?
So this Mahindra, this is continuous deployment, right?
Continuous integration it is.
Integration, sorry.
Yeah, this part is continuous integration, and after it is successfully completed, it will then trigger continuous deployment.
Deployment, okay.
Now, what is benefit of using these two switches here? Believe me, you can have an application, a containerized application set up in such a way that whenever any of your developer makes any changes to the main branch, okay, or to the main development branch, and push those changes to central repository, automatically your new container images will be built. And not just that, it will automatically also trigger a Kubernetes deployment. Getting my point?
Yeah, Mahindra, just one question. Yes. Like given an application, like suppose if you have an application where you do integration, okay? Mm-hmm. So normally as a developer, we will write some integration test, okay? So
yes.
So normally I will take just example of my project in which like we have written, we are using a ESB, okay, toolkit. So okay. Integrate with a number of outside world application using API and also. Normally right. we have written an integration test, but it will try to call that particular service, and once we are able to integrate that, the build will get passed. If it failed, then it will, the build will not be generated. So in this case, in this case, how can we implement that scenario?
See, implementing that scenario here would be a little difficult. What you will have to do is, in that case, your application is basically what you are explaining me is kind of a distributed application. Application which depends on too many external services.
Maybe right? Like we can create a mock for that, and we will...
Yes, you will have to create some kind of mock for that. And basically what you do, you manage all that in your delivery pipeline. You will see here, my delivery pipeline is anyway completed successfully, as you can see it here, right?
Yeah.
Let me just go to the edit mode. Just wanted to show you something. What you should do in your dev environment, you first deploy to dev environment. In dev environment, add a step that will actually deploy all the necessary external mock services before deploying your real application.
Yeah.
Getting my point?
Correct.
Right? Then run the test cases.
Okay.
To check whether application is able to interact with those mock services. And if everything is fine, then your release creation is completed successfully. That would be your first stage. What you should be doing next then you will have one more stage here, right? This would be your production stage, where you will not be creating any mock services,
correct,
where you will be actually putting it in production. Getting my point?
But like, is it advisable, like for production, apart from dev, I can understand, okay, that mock and all will be deployed on that particular server and we can test it. There won't be any network connectivity issue.
Yeah,
but like,
see, there are multiple deployment patterns, for example. You might actually use green-blue deployment pattern then. That means,
correct,
instead of deploying it into production, deploy it into a staging environment first. Run the test in stage, whether... You just want to check whether in production-like environment your application is able to communicate with all services. If everything is working just fine, swap production environment with staging with production.
Yeah, because normally what currently we are doing, we are using Jenkins, okay, as a build server.
Right.
So there we are doing it we are using our own MSI. So whenever we check in the code, it will
create
a job and it will start running and it will test all the test cases. So once it is passed, we'll create a build for that. But when we are creating a release for a deployment in other environment staging like UAT preprod, we don't run that integration test.
Right. That's what we do.
I wanted to try how to implement my scenario using this Azure DevOps pipeline. So I'm just trying
Can you see here? Whenever you go to the next stage, there is an option whether you want that to be happen automatically or you want that to be happen manually. Can you see that?
Yeah.
And you can also have an option. You just have to refer to Azure DevOps documentation pages for that. There is an option called release gate. An automated check. So if something doesn't work in this environment, then do not go to the next environment or do not deliver your application to the next stage then. That you can control. Okay. Now, just a minute. I guess our application is already deployed. So we should just go and check. Kubectl, get pod, get service, and get deployment. I want to see what pod, what service, and what deployment it has created. Wait a second, it should actually allow me to show all of them at once, right? Can you see this? It has created two pods, one for application, one for database. Can you see it has created one application service, which is load balancer, and you will see the external IP address of it. Here it is. This is my application, by the way. Can you see that? Hello?
Yeah, Mahendra, yeah.
Right? Okay. Okay, fine. So application is deployed correctly now. Okay, now let me show you one more important thing here. Many times people also ask me a question. What if there are no changes made in application source code? But what if one of our Kubernetes developer has made changes to Kubernetes artifacts instead? Like what about, let's say, my development team has decided that instead of exposing this particular application directly to load balancer type service, we want to put it behind ingress controller. Getting my point?
Good question. Yeah.
It can be implemented here quite easily. You know what you just have to do? Just make changes to this YAML files. Right? You can even create a new ingress.yaml file here for ingress connectivity, right? As you made some changes to this repository, you know what your build pipeline will do? Your build pipeline will run again. It will create a fresh container image. It will just copy the fresh Kubernetes artifacts and hand them over to the release pipeline. And can you see what I have done in my release pipeline here? Look at this step, this task. It's just going to apply all the configuration files directly from this location to Kubernetes server. Is that clear?
Yeah.
So if you make changes to Kubernetes artifact and commit the changes, it will run the release, it will run the build pipeline again, and it will run the release pipeline again. Is that clear?
Yeah.
Like for example, just a final example, and then we will wind it up, okay? Then we will have a question answer for another 5 minutes. KTS, and let's say, okay, I just want to make changes to this app deployment. Right now, my application is having just one replica, okay? I just wanted to change that. Here, let me press enter and say replicas equal to 3. What does it mean?
It will create a three
copies of this application. Let's do a commit. Now, after I do a commit, it will automatically trigger a new pipeline. Even though there is no changes made in application source code, changes is not made in application code, changes are made in Kubernetes artifact. But still, it is better to, you know, just rebuild entire application and run all the tests and everything again. It won't take much time on this private build agent. Because in private build agent, nothing is deleted after build is completed. It retains all the artifacts and everything. Okay, let's go to the release pipeline. And you will notice a new release will be created here. Can you see that?
Yeah.
Release 2. That's our new release. It's now just waiting for our agent. And once agent is made available, it will start its work.
So we can check the pods, like 3 pods.
Yes, we will just go and check the pod once it's done. Looks like there is already an incident happening here. As your pipeline, there could be a delay in running an actual pipeline if you are using Microsoft hosted build agents. Yeah, we are using Microsoft hosted agent. Agent is made available. It will now do the kubectl apply in just a few minutes now. Okay, it's already started. There is one more benefit of using apply command, by the way. What if resource is already there? Apply will not fail it. Wait a second. It is rather failing. Looks like one of the artifact has some error. App deploy.yaml. Have I modified a write file actually? I might have made some mistake in this YAML file.
Do we need to make add replica set or replica? What is it?
You can write replicas directly here in the deployment itself. Oh, I wrote it at wrong place. It is not a property of template. It is property of deployment object. I made changes at wrong place. It should be here. YAML files are very difficult or requires lot of care whenever you make changes to them. Because there is no such property in pod template. I was using it at wrong place. Anyway, just 1 or 2 minutes and it should be done. I will not open my build pipeline. I'll just go to the release pipeline directly. I'm expecting release number 3 in few minutes now. Any questions so far? Meanwhile, any questions, anyone?
Mahendra, just one question. Like, I don't remember like whether you have shown us that token where we find it.
Token where image name is written, right? Token for image name, right?
Because we are using one utility, right, for token.
Yes, yes. I will show you once the job completes. I guess it is completed already. Builder job is completed already, so I can disconnect this. Pipeline. Okay, just completed. Fine. I'll show you here. If I just go to the work directory and 1/s, this is source code. Create as deployment. Let me show you content of this file. appdeploy.yaml. Can you see it has already placed image name here instead of that placeholder?
Yes.
Right? So when we actually run kubectl apply, it's not actually getting that file. It's getting this one. And I will also check if, wait a second, but still I'm not getting that replica property here. I was expecting replica property to be there now. appdeploy.yaml. I was expecting a replica property. Oh, I guess I have written this property in the wrong place. I did not make changes to. Okay, I have done updated this one. appdeploy.yaml. Let me check. Yeah, replicas I have mentioned there. Let me check my next release pipeline. It has published successfully, completed successfully. Yeah, great, great. Okay, this might be just showing the old format to me. This is just the old file. Okay, let me just check it here, deployment. Can you see my deployment is updated now? Earlier it was image number 555. And now it is image number 557. Can you see the changes now? And there are also 3 replicas now for my application. Okay.
Yeah.
Fine. Any questions you have? We will then wind it up.
Just share that Ansible video which you discussed, like you have created one.
Yeah, I'll share the link with you just a minute.
Right. So we can access this code, right? Just on read only.
Yeah, yeah. This GitHub link will be always available to you.
Okay.
Wait a second. Have you people got a link for YouTube channel?
Yeah, we do got it.
Yeah, fine. Then you can find it there once it is uploaded there.
Fine.
Okay. No. You can find all those recordings and those videos there. I will upload that Ansible recording as well. Okay, for your reference. Any questions, anyone? I'll just perform a cleanup operation now, just to save the cost. That is AZ group delete, and my group name was AKS demo. Okay then, thank you everyone for connecting with me today.
Yeah, thank you Bendra for sharing the information. It was a really nice session. Thank you very much.
Welcome. For any, if you want to learn more about AKS, the prerequisite is you will have to first learn something about containers. What is container, how to build container, how to use containers and so on. Then you can start learning Kubernetes or AKS. Okay. And of course, for all the practicals, you need Azure subscription. You can get one free subscription by signing up at Azure. Wait a second, I'll share the URL for that. Azure free.
But that will be only for monthly, right?
Yeah, that is only for 30 days. And connect with our channel, our Synergetics channel for this open source community. You will get to know about our future events there, information about future events if you have, whatever events we will have. Yeah. Okay, thank you everyone. We'll sign out now.
Thank you so much, Mahendra sir, for the wonderful session.
Yeah.
Everyone, I need your 5 minute attention. So I'm just sharing my screen for a moment. So I hope my screen is visible, right? So I'll be real quick. Hello.
Yeah, it's visible. Yeah.
Okay, so basically, I just want to introduce about our community. So Mahendra sir has already mentioned this. So emerging technology community, which is available, which we have created on Meetup, okay, is open for all the people who are interested in, various emerging technologies like artificial intelligence, machine learning, big data analytics, IoT, cloud, DevOps, open source. So all you have to just do, install an Meetup app on your phone. And you have to just search for the community, which is emerging technology community. And then you just have to follow it. So you will be updated about events, meetups, webinars, and workshops that are going to happen in future. Once again, as we have said earlier, that we are going to share the YouTube recording with you. We are going to upload the recording on YouTube. So please do follow our YouTube channel. Your feedback is important to us. So I've already shared the link. So once again, I'm sharing all the links. So please do feel feedback form. So it will help us to improvise on the techniques and with your suggestions. Okay. So I'll be sharing all the links with you guys. So if you find any problem while opening the shortened links, so please let me know. I'm also sharing the full link. So I've shared all the links. Please do check. So thank you for attending this session. Have a great weekend, everyone. Thank you.